So it's going to be the first time everyone finds out whether the breakthrough late is on that opening lap. You know, this isn't, they're not obviously nowhere near it. Racing speed here. So if you're following the guy in front and he breaks too late and goes straight on and you break in the same place, you're following him.
Well, you say they're nowhere near racing speed. I wonder whether they are actually close to racing speed or not. We've got no idea what little grip there might be available. Now, I am here. I've just double-checked. I'm hearing there will only be a single formation lap. That is not normally the way these things work. If you've not had dry running, normally two formation laps are mandatory, but if they're going with one, we will wait and see when Huffy gets the line, whether he comes steaming through or whether he pulls up. He's not too far away now either. We're already turn 10. You see, look, this big block in the middle of old paint covered over by black paint. That'll be like glass.
A change of surface on the back straight scenario is pretty dangerous. The change of surface is turn 6. You have no idea what you're going to get, and the paint is seriously slippery. Like, zero.
Yeah, that's indicative, isn't it? You know, these surface changes, and Rob's not scared of things, and for him to say that things are dangerous on the straights, let alone in the corners.
Every motorcycle racer knows that when it's wet, you do not ride over the white bits of a zebra crossing or on any painted lines, because they are like glass. Now, the problem is, the painted lines here aren't white. They've been painted over with black paint. So they're not as visible, but they are just as glassy. Now, Rob is coming to a halt, so there is only a single formation lap to try and guess the grip levels on a street circuit. That seems to me to be not enough. Cars on the grid on the street circuit of Marrakesh. The main race, round 4 of the World Touring Car Championship. It is very wet. Hugo Vallon starts from the pit on the right. Rob Huff on pole on the left. Norbert Mikulic, the fourth on the grid. Jose Maria Lopez, as you can see his red nose. He is not in his pit box. He has started out of his pit box. Honda can protest that and have him handed a drive-through penalty. Huff has got to lead this into the first corner. And Montero and Mikulic have to allow Muller to battle Lopez. They have got to survive the first 3 or 4 corners without the Citroens getting through. Montero might be the one who's in trouble here, because Lopez is alongside him and goes through. Montero will have the inside line, but Lopez has completed the pass already. He's picked off one of the Honda trio. But you pointed it out silently off air, he was not in his grid box. That is a drive-through penalty. It has been in the past.
And you can see why he did it, because on his right-hand side, his front wheel was on a painted line, so he's obviously pulled left of the grid box to get more traction. But as you say, Martin, he was out of his grid box, and that's not okay.
If I was Dario Desposito, I would already have the protest in with Miracar Race Director. You can see how much water there is in the air down the back straight. They're not going an awful lot quicker than they were in the formation lap. Temp Jurk picks up a place in the background from Gabriele Tarquini, or retakes a place from, was that Tarquini or Valente? Looks like Tarquini. And Muller drifting out a little wide in the second in the red Citroens. Then Tom Coronel holding everybody up. Now, Mikulic has got to be a rear gunner for himself and for Huff, because if he allows Lopez to get clear, or to get close rather, then Lopez may well pick him off.
Yeah, and it's, you think Mikulic might try and, well, not just say he's not doing it now, but he may try and push. They know Muller's not as quick.
Trouble in the background, lots of yellow cars running out wide. I think Coronel lost several positions. Coronel was sixth. And in the background, there's a Larder come through in front with damage on the nose. Don't know who it is. He had a bit of bodywork on that's flown off. So there was trouble behind.
That'll be Vallon, I think.
Or Tarquini. Not sure. What, it won't be Katzberg anyway, having started. If it's Katzberg, then I don't know where he found the shortcut. Well, Huff and Mikulic now have really got to let this settle down. The Citroens don't look like they've got the grip that the Hondas have.
No, from the rear end, both those Citroens are breaking away quite readily, aren't they, in the middle of the corner.
Well, that's good news for Thiago, isn't it? You know, he got jumped at the start. The Citroens, greater acceleration, better traction worked for him. James Thompson down the inside of Tom Chilton, former Vauxhall drivers. And through goes Thompson. He picks off Chilton for 10th. Coronel is 9th, and it's Valente and Tarquini who are 6th and 7th. Ahead of Banani from 13th on the grid. Wow, Banani must have had a good opening lap.
Yeah, that's mega. He's obviously found the shortcut somewhere.
Yeah. local knowledge.
Yeah.
Of a track that nobody's raced on before. Doesn't exist. There is no shortcut. That was just a great start. And Bonani keeping his nose dry. You know, he had a tough time in qualifying. The car was kind of quick enough in free practice. Then they made a change for qualifying. It wasn't better. Thompson trying to come around Coronel. Coronel defending, but Jimmy T with a bit of a run on him there. Coronel doesn't allow him to get close enough.
Coronel's got quite a lot of damage on the back there, and it looks like Vallon yet again has more damage on the front of his car.
Yeah. Well, now, you see, where Bonani was coming through, I'm not sure it was necessarily the larder that outbraked itself into Coronel. I have a feeling there was a bit of a concertina effect going on from behind. Whatever it is, Coronel has lost several places, and he's now come back towards Jimmy Thompson, who's coming forwards. Is it raining as hard as it was? We're seeing purple sectors now, which means that the cars, the drivers probably, are finding a little more grip or getting used to the lack of grip and starting to speed up. Dominic Greiner watching Jimmy Thompson.
Bit of understeer there from Jimmy.
Yeah, he's in 10th, which is where he started. And the problem here is there is a bit of rubber online. There's a lot of dirt and oil and so on. Oil from the tarmac offline. There's not very much grip anywhere. And look at the surface just in front of the camera there. That's all black paint. Coronel meandering down the straight. So is Thompson as they hit that black paint. Battle for 9th and 10th position. Two Chevrolets, Tom Coronel, the yellow car, black car of James Thompson. They are slowly losing touch with the Larders and the Citroen in front. Citroen in front, you can see the red, white, and green of Morocco and the car of Mehdi Bonani. Again, Thompson with a really good round out of corner 10. And this is where Coronel was weak in the first race. Remember, we used to see that Lopez was all over the back of him down that back straight.
Coronel, I would imagine Thompson's probably got Coronel there. He seemed to turn in a little bit later and got a real good launch off the corner.
Let's hold the shot, hold the shot. Bonani didn't see it, no. Coronel held off Thompson, who's now under threat from Tom Chilton. The problem was Jimmy T was going to have to go the long way around the outside into that left-hand 90-degree corner 11, and that was always going to be a tough ask unless Tom let him go. Tom's not really inclined to let him go, I don't think.
No, you're right.
In race one, he wouldn't have taken him out to stop him winning, but that was race one. That's all done and dusted. This is race two. Thompson getting away, Coronel rather, getting away from Thompson, who now has to deal with Tom Chilton. So it's been the same deal here for Jimmy Thompson that it was for Coronel in the first race, trying to hold off Lopez, is that the Citroen has got very strong low-speed acceleration and traction, particularly out of corner 10 down the little back straight.
Tomo's mega through sector two, as is Coronel as well though, so I think obviously he's lost that pace to Chilton. Chilton's caught him as a result of that attempt to pass on Coronel, but look, he's already closing back into Coronel.
Yes, he is starting to move away from the Citroen. The Volvo behind is Ted Bjerk. Look again at start, not a great getaway from Norbert Michelitz. Looks like it was even worse for Thiago Lopez once more. Whatever gearing they're using on the Citroen this weekend really works at low speed. Look, Muller got inside him, and Lopez just kept his calm. That was Fredrik Ekblom outbraking himself at the first turn. No contact there. Lopez, little rub with Montero. Thiago desperately trying to keep the overlap into the braking area, but Lopez braked desperately late and still held it.
That little clip as Lopez tried to come back left, it actually turned him a little bit and kind of managed to force him in front of where he was before.
Yeah, it helped rotate the car though as he was getting in late on the brakes almost. Well, you just saw Bonani as well there trying to get down the inside of Tarquini, and they are still nose to tail. Tarquini 7th, Bonani 8th. As the race settles down, Huff and Michelitz are going away a little bit from Lopez. So again, like race one, here we go for Lopez. What's the deal here? Your biggest championship rival, your closest championship rival is Thiago Montero, and he is behind you. Ivan Muller is behind him. The only guys that are going to outscore him at the moment are further back than Montero, Michelitz and Huff. All right, if conditions change and the race comes to you, then you can start to attack. Right now, We're on lap five. We've done five laps of 22.
Oh, he's run right.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Now is not the time to make a mistake. Montero gets alongside and shows no mercy. I was just going to say, this is the time now for Lopez to really consolidate that third place, take no risks and see how the race plays out. As it is, just an indication there, although it looks fairly pedestrian because nobody's banging wheels, these cars are being driven right on the edge of adhesion.
And it's so slippery that it can just be like turning in on a line that you missed the previous lap or you haven't found, or braking on, because every single lap they're going faster and faster as the track slightly dries and they're learning where the grip is. But we just saw Lopez just run a little bit deep there and a little bit of understeer, and through goes Montero.
Yeah, and onto a wetter bit of track that has less grip than the less wet racing line does. I mean, it's still raining, the racing line is still damp, there's no question about that. There might just be a little bit more grip there. Huff and Michelitz, first and second, starting to pull away. We're now back to Honda 1-2-3.
Michelitz half a second faster than Huff on that last lap, but I'm sure they won't give each other too much trouble.
No, Norby's not going to do anything stupid. And we talked about this in the first race, you know, with your teammate as Coronel jiffed out very wide in turn three. Jimmy T trying to get a run on the inside, down to the hairpin, or the chicane rather. Hasn't got an overlap, has to tuck in behind.
It's going to bring Chilton back into the mix as well.
Well, great game of cat and mouse between them. Well, it allowed Thompson to close right up. I don't think it's allowed Chilton to close up that much. Watch the gap from Benani, 2.6 seconds. Starting to grow a little. And Montero with Lopez trying to find that traction out of turn 10. It's not working for him the way it works against Coronel, is it? Honda picks up its skirts and walks away there from the Citroen, and you don't see that very often, and that's Demoustier. He's gone off on the exit of the chicane, and he's lost the engine, or clanged the barriers. It's a tyre wall there, and that's the replay of Lopez just getting in a tiny bit deep. Ooh, was that because he had a bit of a...
Yeah,
he lunge at Norby.
I think he just locked up. I think he hit there's a bit of a different patch of the circuit, and he locked up, and it looked like it was quite close to hitting Michelitz, but I don't think it was too close.
Montero now sets the fastest race lap. Valente goes out wide. Gabrielli won't have any of that coming back up the inside. Hugo, come on! I mean, I know there wasn't a lot of room there, but there was enough room not to be hitting Gabrielli, you know. You've gone out wide, you're on the paint, you know what's going to happen, you know Gabrielli's there, you know he's going to run out wide.
Yeah, maybe should have yielded, but...
Should have lifted a fraction.
It's his guys team, like a little bit of road, didn't
he? I know. You were right about Chilton, obviously, the racing driver's eye spots it. Coronel, Thompson and Chilton as one now, and Tom is struggling for traction, isn't he?
Yeah, Coronel's holding Thompson up now, and Thompson's going to... Probably have to force the issue if he's not careful.
Debris on the exit of turn one. It's lard of bits and bobs, isn't it? That's the exit of turn 10. There's a green flag there, and that may well be that Demoustier has sort of crawled around and died in the corner there. Not him, obviously, but his car. Not quite sure whether he's made it out. He's still going. Not showing much. He's in sector one.
Montero, fastest lap of the race last time round.
And he's closing up on his teammates. But importantly, pulling away from Lopez and trying to make sure that Lopez can't get back to him.
That was a good lap as well.
Yeah. Now, the difference will only be 3 points, but it's 3 points that might be vital later on in the season in Montero's favour. Thompson is now... sorry. Tomo is now starting to get a bit frustrated, I think, not being able to get by Tom. Because Tom Chilton right behind, Coronel and Chilton teammates last year. Oh, and Tomo drifts out a little wide, and the Citroen's got good traction on the inside. Luckily, the next corner is a long right, but then a hard braking episode and into a left-hander, so Tomo needed to get his nose back in front, or his tail back in front, and he does. Fitzer and Ekblom, this is for 15th, and the young Hungarian has just gone by the Volvo-driving veteran Swede. So, whatever else, we know that the Zengo Motorsport Honda has got some grip. This is only his third race weekend for Enz. Fredrik Ekblom, runner-up in last year's Swedish Touring Car Championship, to his teammate who's just in front, Ted Björk. what is the gap. They were 4 seconds apart. Looks like more than that last on this lap, but... So Coronel still hanging on to ninth place. Doesn't really want to let Thompson go, because it's a few less points in the Independence Championship, the Yokohama, or the World Touring Car Trophy, rather. And Benani in front is scoring maximum points at the moment. He's already the points leader. Rob Huff, fastest race lap, 133.4. And Benani up the roads to the tune of about 5 seconds now. No, less than that. Just under 3 seconds ahead of Coronel.
Like I say, this suits Coronel quite nicely, actually. I know Benani is ahead, but it pushes Chilton a little bit further behind him.
It's, yeah.
Because Thompson's not in for the full season, it basically gives him a little buffer and takes a few more points away from Chilton.
Katzberg out of the pit lane, where he started, and up to 13th, attacking John Philippi for 12th. Philippi fourth in the WTCC trophy at the moment, or in this race at any rate. The only problem for Coronel is, if he doesn't let Tomo by, Benani will go further up the road in a mistake from Michelitz. Drifts out wide, and suddenly Montero has to worry about where Norby's going and what Lopez is doing. And Lopez now, this is the sniff of blood in the water that he needs to try and attack the Hondas in front once more. Right on the back bumper of Thiago, his closest championship rival.
That looked almost a carbon copy of what Lopez did, didn't it? Just slightly deep in, runs a little bit wide, a bit of understeer where he really needs it not to be, and pushed him out a little bit wide, cost him quite a big chunk of time there.
More spray in the air to my eye, Harry, on the front straight. It looks like it's actually starting to get considerably wetter in the last lap or so.
It does.
Maybe just on this bit of track.
Some people are still doing their personal best, although that was a previous lap round, so in the last lap it has started to come down a little bit heavier.
Well, last lap, Lopez set the fastest first sector of all, but it definitely looks a lot wetter on the pit straight, and maybe it's further back up to corner 10 as well. Maybe it is wetter, definitely. Maybe they got more rain on corner 10, and that's what caught Norby out, although he has just set the fastest first sector of the race. So they are still the top three, all setting personal bests and race best first sectors on this lap.
Certainly looks like the rain's still coming down hard, but maybe the guys are just finding where the grip is and using that better to their advantage.
Well, they're 10 laps into their fuel allocation as well, so the car is a little less lardy with fuel. Maybe that makes a difference. My thinking here for Coronel is, if you let Tomo go, slipstream behind him up the straight, work together as two. At the moment, they're holding each other up. If the faster car's in front, they might catch Benani. Tomo might get by, sneaky slides in the door. Well, it's a moot point now because Coronel runs out of grip and Thompson goes through. So now Coronel has to hold off Chilton, who is a rival in the WTCC trophy, and Tom sends it down the inside.
So Coronel had to let him go there, didn't he?
Yeah. Defended too long, Tom, didn't he?
Yeah, good opportunist move from Chilton, though. Like, that's just that surface change, you know? The back just broke away from him.
Yeah.
Not a lot he can do there, apart from sitting.
Well, he's always struggling for grip there. Now, can Chilton get by? So, Coronel, our opening race winner, loses two spots. Can Chilton get by Thompson and start to attack his own teammate, Mehdi Benani? Norbert Michelis sets another fastest race lap, 133.11. The Hondas, personal best laps for Michelitz and Montero. And Huff, a personal best first sector again on this lap. So although it looks wetter down the front straight, clearly they are still finding grip.
Yeah, interestingly, the Citroens look like they're struggling in these conditions more so than the Hondas. As you say, the top three Hondas are trading faster sector times, constantly putting their own personal bests in, but we're not seeing anything like that from Lopez or Muller, or actually any of them.
Last lap, Huffy was the slowest of the Hondas with a 33.6. The faster of the two Citroens was Lopez with a 33.9. So he lost 3/10 to Huff, and the other two cars were quicker than Huffy.
You see Chilton's back end squirreling around there on the lines. That's where it looks at the rear end looks real nervous on the Citroen.
Yeah. James Thompson now in ninth position. Mehdi Benani was 4.7 seconds up the road at the end of the previous lap 10. lap 11 now completed. Leaders on lap 12. Tom Chilton's headlights flashing away. Sure that's going to affect Jimmy T too much. He's now head down and charging and perhaps ruining the lost time when he could have been trying to close down Mehdi Benani six, seven laps ago.
Personal best, sector two time there as well. Pretty much the same as Rob Love's sector two on that same lap.
Well, it'll be interesting now to see Benani comes across the line at the end of the lap. Last lap for him was the 35.7, James Thompson a 35.3, so 0.4 of a second. Thompson not really defending against Tom Chilton, who set a 35.6. So Tomo with clear track in front of him, really free to try and just charge up to... And again, you know, like with Coronel, it might have been better to let Thompson through early, not over-defend and try and go with him. And I think maybe the deal now for Tom Chilton, although Thompson effectively is invisible for points, he's not, because he will take points away from Chilton. What Chilton's got to do is go with Tomo until and unless they catch Benani, follow him. Well, let's hear what Norby's got to say in the middle of the Honda trio.
Is it possible for Rob to go faster?
Is it possible for Rob to go faster? If it was, he might, do you think? I don't know. He's just set another personal best first sector, Rob Huff, but the rest of the lap, not so much. Personal best final sector. So Rob Huff just does a 33.2, Norby a 33.4, Thiago a 33.4. So, yes, thank you, Norby. It is possible for Huffy to go quicker. And the question there was because Norby is worried that Thiago and he are getting backed up towards Lopez, isn't he?
Yeah, he just wants to put a bit of clear air between them and the Citroen, I guess. But it's also that inter team battle as well. Norby will want to, you know, he wants to beat Huffy at the end of the day, despite them being teammates. So any points he can score whenever he can. If he feels he can go faster, then he probably needs to push up on the back of Huff and show the team that rather than maybe ask the question. But yeah, I mean, they also need to play it sensibly as well. There's no point in those three. They're fairly safe where they are now. They don't need to be trying to have an inter-team race when all they're risking doing is going off.
Poor old Zoe is dying a thousand deaths in the garage watching Jimmy T. He is pulling away, though, from Tom Chilton. He's dealt with the pace of the Citroen. On board with Nicky Katzberg, 12th place. That's Coronel's car in front. Katzberg is a long way back, though. Lots of rain, lots of spray on the streets of Marrakesh. This is the third wet race weekend we have had in four weekends so far. We've had five different winners from our seven races so far. Jose Maria Lopez, the only multiple race winner. He's won three times. He was second in our opening race here. Rob Huff won once. He won the opening race in Le Castellet Circuit Paul Ricard. He's on target at the moment to add a second victory to his tally, and that will help to close him up in the championship standing as well. If he came in here in fourth position in the standings. In fact, he is 8 points behind Mehdi Benani, and at the moment, he will move up a spot ahead of the Moroccan driver. But Lopez is not done yet. Harry Folkard still attacking hard, still pushing with everything he's got.
Yeah, he needs to keep the pressure on because that's how you force them into making a mistake. If he just backed off now, the three Hondas would just go away and do their own thing. But him being there, him still pushing, makes them have to keep pushing as well. So that's how you cause an unforced error, which is ultimately how Lopez has ended up back in fourth from third position ahead of Montero.
And most of all, of course, the one Honda he's most likely to force an error from is the most important one at the moment, the one who's closest in points, Thiago Montero, who's right in front of him.
Yeah, and we've already heard the Michelet-Huff situation where Michelet is asking if Huff can go any faster. If Lopez was 5 seconds behind him, then that wouldn't even be a... It wouldn't even be worth bringing up on the radio, you know?
Yeah, and Lopez, this Muller is... Muller is already nearly over 6 seconds behind Lopez. But Lopez is 8 tenths behind, or was 8 tenths behind on the last lap, Thiago Montero. That gap goes out by another couple of tenths. Lopez. How fast Nicky Katzberg's pulling in Tom Coronel, by the way. Two laps ago, he was a straight in front. Coronel is really, really struggling.
Yeah, he is. He's having major problems. But we spoke about it actually earlier on. He's running seven degrees of toe out across his rear axle. So that's absolutely huge. And that won't be very much fun in these conditions.
But 7 degrees on each wheel. It's 14 degrees of total toe out. That's an astonishing figure. I mean, that's more than you would normally find on the front of a front-wheel drive race car by quite some margin.
Lopez is really on it now. He put the fastest final sector in on the previous lap. He's now just done the fastest first sector on this lap. He's lapping at the same, well, slightly faster than Montero, so he is really applying the pressure now.
Katzberg attacking Coronel for 11th, but Lopez is all over the back of Montero for third place. Honda driver will be under real pressure.
Tomo can smell blood as well. He's dropped that gap from 4 seconds to 2.4 seconds.
Okay, we really don't want to see this battle entertaining as it is, because Lopez is all over the back of Thiago Montero. Tom Chilton just sets the fastest first sector. So maybe the track is starting to dry again.
It's coming back to the Citroens now. Hondas were walking away with fastest sector times, individual personal best everywhere, but we're now seeing the Citroens coming back into their own, so maybe you're right, perhaps the drying line is benefiting the Citroen a little bit.
Katzberg versus Coronel for 11th, no points at stake. Coronel in a car that is frankly looking a bit of an evil handful. I bet he's glad it didn't handle like this in the opening race when he was leading in the wet. It was dry when he was leading. That would have been a very different kettle of fish for him and the Roal Motorsport team. Gabriele Tarquini, fastest final sector of the lap. That's the 11, 12 and across the starting line sector. Lopez, another personal best. Muller, personal fastest lap of the race. So Muller has brought himself closer to contention.
Lopez down to almost half a second from the back of Montero now. Look, he's all over the back of him.
Thank you. Well, there was a brief view of the leaders. Muller is closing up. Muller, purple first sector as well. So the top five are four of our top five in the championship, five of our top six. And our opening race winner, Tom Coronel, trying to hang on to 11th position ahead of Nicky Katzberg. But gets very deep into the chicane. Just manages to get it stopped up. This is quite frustrating, Harry, for the driver behind. He's got more pace, but nowhere really to use it. And he's going to have to wait till Coronel drifts offline and makes another error. And sooner or later, that is going to come.
Yeah, and we can see the two drying wheel tracks everywhere now as well. So it's going to make, you know, a move off that line even more difficult than it was at the start of the race.
Question now is, whose wet tyres are tired and whose aren't? Huffy's still leading, but more purple sectors from Lopez and Muller in the Citroens.
Okay, the last time that we rode together is 33.4 and I've just done a 33.3. Why is Norby on my arse when I've done?
Well, Norby is right up his exhaust pipe because he wants to get away from Thiago to give Thiago room to manoeuvre, because Lopez is half a car length behind the third of the Hondas. I know Rob is feeling the pressure, but at the moment, I don't think he's feeling the pressure as much as Thiago. Svetlana preparing her report for the Lada team as Katzberg has gone through. So he's up to 11th. Gabriele Tarquini, Hugo Valente in 6th and 7th. This is where it happened. Sure enough, Tom just ran out of grip again at turn 10. That's really been the Achilles heel of that car all weekend, Harry, wet or dry.
Yeah, it's been breaking into there and he's struggled with traction off that corner, but been awesome pretty much everywhere else. And weirdly, that is in sector 2 where he was so quick in the dry. So.
Yeah. Whatever else with the setup between free practice and race day, it didn't affect turn 10 very well. Top four is still a breakaway group. Rob Huff leads, Norbert Michelis, Thiago Montero, Jose Maria Lopez. Ivan Muller on his own in fifth position. He's 6 seconds behind the leaders and four ahead of Gabriele Tarquini, who just set the fastest race lap. Tarquini with his teammate Hugo Valente now 3 or 4 seconds behind him. So Tarquini's blazing his own trail. And then Mehdi Benarni, the top WTCC trophy driver, he's leading the standings and he's leading that little race as well in eighth place. James Thompson, though, has taken 2 seconds out of him in the last 4 laps. And there are 6 remaining, including this one.
I think Tomo must have just made a mistake on that lap because he was down to 1.7 behind him. He's now dropping 2.7, so he's lost a second somewhere.
So he had closed the gap down from 6 to under 2, and that's what happens when you push on. You see how much drier it is on parts of the track, but where it's not sheltered from the wind and the rain, it is actually still pretty slippery. And the difference now, Harry, is if you do put a wheel off the line, then suddenly there's much less grip rather than a tiny bit less as there would be in the dry.
Yeah, and look, they're coming up on the back markers. I'm sure they'll get out of the way.
Well, he can't now, Ekblom, because this is 11 and 12. Ekblom's basically going to have to drive through the pits to stay out of the way or go hard immediately right.
That would have been good to have seen what was going on there. But so that's where Benarni found a bit of time. That's where the second came from.
Yeah. So now, okay, he's got a bit of ground on Tomo. Ekblom's going to crawl to a halt here, let the leaders go through. It's unfortunate for Tomo that Benarni probably isn't going to get a penalty for that. He's actually going to get an advantage. He didn't deliberately straight line the chicane. He just missed his braking and skated out wide. Huff and Mikulicz are going away from Montero and leaving Thiago to kind of wrestle with Lopez all on his own. And it's going to come down to wrestling soon, isn't it? Because Lopez is about to join battle really seriously now.
It is. He's right on the back of Montero, but it's tough, isn't it? Lopez doesn't need it. He doesn't need to get involved in a tangle there.
Nope, he doesn't need to get involved in a tangle, but again, he's just at another fastest race lap. So he is right up behind Thiago.
Yeah, if you can get close enough to Thiago to give him a couple of little taps like we saw with Coronel, just to let him know he's there, nothing sinister, but then that'll certainly focus Thiago's mind. And
the problem is, when he gave Tom those taps in the dry, there was grip to hold it. In the wet, there won't be. And if he puts Thiago off, he's in the pits. Lopez is going for a drive-through. And if he doesn't, all hell is going to break loose.
You could give him a little tap there, that'd be okay.
I have to say, actually, I'm slightly surprised there's been no investigation into the starting procedure of Lopez. We've seen drivers penalised before this season for starting out of their grid spots.
Yeah, I mean, the way drive-through penalties have been dished out, you'd have thought that would have been a drive-through penalty, but really not.
Coming down like confetti. Well, you know, again, maybe it's that invisible car, the one that didn't get penalised for holding somebody up on a fast lap in Q3 in Slovakia.
Montero getting the hammer down there, fastest second to 2 of anybody again, so he is definitely feeling the pressure there.
He's to get away, doesn't he?
Look at Muller's car wandering around on the straight there. He wasn't even in the braking zone there, but that just shows his rear wet tyres are starting to go off there and it's shuffling around on the blocks.
Norby again, right up behind Rob Huff. That won't be doing much for Huffy's demeanour. Why is Norby right up by Jaxi? Well, he just is. Right on the, not gearbox, but exhaust pipe. Now here again comes Thompson. He's got the bit between his teeth. He's also got the bit between her teeth.
He's also got Dominic Reiner hanging over the wall waving at him, I think.
Come on, Tomo, come on, Tomo. Well, you know, this... It's another good racing performance from James Thompson, a car he still doesn't know well. He's never driven it in the wet up until today. He has now. Hasn't driven it on the street circuit up until today. He has now. And hasn't started on the front row of the grid with it until today, but he has now. But, you know, the hope is that in some of the other races that clash for the team boss, René Munich, he might get called back again to drive the car once more. On board with Norbert Mitchell, in second place, right behind our race leader, Rob Huff. Lap 20 of 22. So there is one to go at the line this time round.
They're obviously struggling
with
tyre temperatures now, because see them moving offline, and obviously they're going around a car there, but you could see Mitchell before popping out and aiming for puddles to try and cool his tyres down.
Now, Fredrik Ekblom and Ted Bjork have both been lapped by the leaders. The Volvos are 15th and 16th. There's one or two things going on here. Either they can't cope with the wet, which we would have noticed, I think, before in some of our previous wet races, or did they actually gamble on slicks on both cars?
I,
or a mixed setup or something. They are so far behind.
Yeah, it's a good
point. It's almost impossible that there's not something really fundamental wrong with the setup of the car.
Yeah, it's a good point, unless they've both just been misfortunate and had accidents. I mean, you'd think it would be a bit of a crazy move to gamble on both cars with such a gamble with that amount of water coming out of the sky at the start of the race.
Well, they're both, yeah, maybe they're both, you know, they're both a lap behind. Maybe they just went with a setup change for the wet that just doesn't work. Don't forget, they've not run that car in the wet on a street circuit and not on one with brand new tarmac. So it's all a bit of a lick your finger and stick it in the air, best engineering guess, isn't it?
Yeah, it is a bit. You can still see Lopez, look at the back end of it moving around it. Doesn't look anywhere near as stable as the Hondas do.
Now there's another battle that we need to know about, and it's not this one. This is John Philippi and Ferenc Fitsia for 13th place. It's the battle for 5th place, because Gabriele Tarquini has just set another fastest race lap. He's just taken another 6 tenths out of Ivan Muller. He is now 1.68 seconds behind Muller for 5th. Tarquini is absolutely flying. And Yvonne and Gabriele, we know, have got a very pleasant history together. If Gabriele comes sending it down the inside on the final lap, he might well get that 5th position. Thompson, meanwhile, still attacking Bonanni. Gap here was 1.38 at the end of the last lap. It is definitely inside that. But we are running out of corners now for Thompson to try and make anything. Leaders are on the last lap, and the battle for 8th place is just about to start the last lap. Huff at the chicane, turn 5 and 6. Norby right behind. Honda started 1-2-3. Lopez broke up that trio, then made an error, and Thiago Montero got back up into 3rd place. He is starting to creep away from Lopez, who normally doesn't relent until after the checkered flag, but it does look as though he's going, do you know what? All right, I'm done with this. 4th place, that'll do.
I think so. I think he's conceded defeat, and it's all over by the shouting now, isn't it?
Although, you see the way he pitched it into there with the tail stepping out, I'm not sure he ever concedes defeat. May just be going, okay, unless you go off, I don't have a way of getting by you without incurring a penalty. Thiago in 3rd place, Tarquini, another fastest race lap behind Ivan Muller. That might be the photo finish, but it is going to be a Honda 1-2-3. Rob Huff, Norbert Michelitz, and Thiago Montero, 1-2-3, a podium sweep for Honda.
What a boy! 1-2-3!
Well, here comes Muller and Tarquini down at the checkered flag. The gap between them, Muller hung on to 4th by half a second ahead of Tarquini, 6 tenths in fact. Ugo Valente should be 7th, he is. And Mehdi Bonanni versus James Thompson. Tomo not going to get close enough to take away 8th position. Bonanni is the top Yokohama driver, top WTCC trophy driver. Thompson in 2nd, Shilton in 3rd, Coronel in 4th. Between him and that position, Nicky Katzberg, and then John Philippi and Ferenc Fitsia. Fitsia not trying anything silly as they head to the line. Last couple of corners. Philippi should have this under control, as long as he doesn't clout that curb on the inside too hard. Fitsia's making a drag race of it though, isn't he? He's really trying to get him all the way to the checkered flag. The flag beats him to it. Well, Fitsia, the last unlapped driver. Ted Bjerk and Fredrik Ekblom in the Volvos, both a lap behind. And Grégoire de Moustier did not complete the race.
Nice little photo down the back straight here. One on the left, one on the right.
Rob Huff there organising a photo for the Honda yearbook, I think. I think he must be able to talk to the other guys there, or he's talking to his engineer, but he said, I'll go in the middle, you go on the left, Thiago, and Norbert, you go on my right. We'll get a great photograph.
Yep. And Lopez and Tarquini get in the background, but it is a triumphant main race in Marrakesh for Honda.
Presented by TAG Heuer, official timekeeper.
The FIA WTCC is delivered by DHL.
A very happy Rob Huff claims his 2nd win of the season. Leads a Honda 1-2-3. 1-2-3 in qualifying, as he claimed pole. 1-2-3 in the race for Alessandro Mariani in the background and the rest of the Yas Honda team. Well, Jose Maria Lopez still our points leader. 3 wins to Huff's 2. So we still have 5 different winners from our 8 races. But Huff and Lopez have more than their rivals. The other winners, of course, are Mehdi Benani, Thiago Montero. And today, Tom Coronel. Coronel winning the opening race. And struggling home all but last in race two. What a difference the weather made to his car. I wonder what it made to the Hondas.
And Rob Huff is the winner of the main race here in Marrakesh. Congratulations, what a race.
Yeah, I mean, so difficult. I mean, we've never been here in the wet. First time we've ever been here, and the car's been great all weekend. Can't thank the Castrol Honda Yas Racing boys enough. Fantastic job, wet, dry. We've conquered this place, and we needed that race to win. Pole position, race win, P6 in race one. Brilliant weekend.
Fantastic. Well done, Rob.
Yeah, can't get better than that, can you? Pole and race win.
12th career pole, 29th career World Touring Car Championship victory, his second of the season. He is second in the all-time standings, incidentally, to Ivan Muller. And in third place, now 5 races behind, is Jose Maria Lopez. Lopez with 2 World Championship titles, though, to Huff's 1. Will either of them lift this year's crown? Will Thiago Montero claim his first World Championship title? Well, Montero still second in the standings. Huff moves up from 4th to 3rd, ahead of Mehdi Benani, and Norby moves up from 6th to 4th, ahead of Muller and Benani. Muller now down from 5th position to 6th position in the standings. Never count him out, but it's a massive mountain to climb.
It is, for this early in the season, that's a big steep hill that he's looking at. He looks like he's standing at